Welcome to today's webinar titled Atoms Integration with MSC Nastran for Better Fatigue Analysis. My name is Yijun Fan, and I'm the Product Marketing Manager for Atoms and EZ5. So Mark Carson will be today's main presenter. Mark, he is the lead application engineer in MSC, and he has been working with real industry problem for over 20 years. He has been with MSC for 16 years and has been working as the consulting and service engineer for a long time. So today we're going to talk about a new workflow that will make fatigue analysis faster and more accurate. So first, this is today's agenda. So in the beginning of today's presentation, I'm going to give a brief introduction about why we should choose Atoms for dynamic load generation. Then Mark is going to take over and introduce some of the analysis for the on the fatigue side and also the whole workflow for this fatigue analysis. Then we're going to give an introduction to the case study about a truck cab durability. After that, we're going to give a about 15 minutes demonstration on both the Nastran side and also Atoms side. And at the end of today's webinar, there will be about 10 minutes Q&A session. So if you have any question during the presentation or the demonstration about either Atoms or MSC Nastran, just type the question down in the Q&A window, and we will have those questions answered during the Q&A session. Okay, first, atoms for loads. So let's begin by answering the question, why is load prediction so important? We know that product failure is always undesirable and often costly. And the post-production failures in the field always means that the manufacturers incur warranty cost, potential loss of business, and also quality reputation damage. And because of these reasons, so predictive analysis tools like FEA and the fatigue life calculation softwares are often used. And but like any analysis, these results are only as good as the input that drives them, in this case, the load. And as designs become more efficient, the effect of the dynamic load become more important. So what are the challenges in the load prediction? Why is load prediction so challenging for at some cases or in some scenarios? So while static loads are often well understood and easily predictable, dynamic loads can be much more difficult to quantify. And this is especially true for the systems with multiple moving parts and the complex interactions and a dynamic phenomenon like this car or this excavator. So furthermore, physical testing for loads can be expensive, time-consuming, and also occur too late in the design process. And particularly for those physical tests where the manufacturer just cannot afford to have multiple physical tests due to the size and cost of their products. So as a result, FEA can be based on some inaccurate loads, or sometimes people use assumptions as the boundary conditions for those loads. So why is Atoms the solution for generating the loads? Because within Atoms, one can perform system-level multi-body dynamic simulation to quickly and accurately predict loading throughout complex systems. And it's much easier in the design process and over a larger range of design variants, which allows us to perform some of the component-level FEA confidently, since using the accurate Atoms loads will produce meaningful stress results. And also, with accurate stress histories, failure life prediction or calculation can be performed confidently as well, thus allowing for like important product cost reduction, like reduced weight. So this is some of the applications engineers use atoms for load prediction. So in addition to needing those loads for input, FEA, and fatigue analysis, atoms loads are often also used for other applications such as motor sizing and various vibration analysis. This slide shows some example applications. And here are a few more example applications from the defense, electronics, biomedical, and energy industries. Okay, that's what I'm going to briefly introduce about atoms for load. Then I'm going to pass the presenter to Mark, and he is going to continue with the presentation.
All right, thanks, Yujun.
Okay. Okay, we can see your screen.
All right. Okay, good. So what I want to start out talking about is when we have fatigue at the center of your analysis process, which is often the case for making design decisions when you have complex loadings such as road loads, because of the fact that you need to include so many different events, so many different durations of time histories, so many different types of cycling that your structure could go through. And this is a kind of a look at the standard process that you have right now with a fatigue at the center of it. Of course, you've got your three main inputs you need to put into a fatigue analysis, loads, materials, and your stresses from FEA. But as you can see, it can be a bit of a complicated and convoluted process to iterate manually when you're doing a what I call now an unembedded fatigue solution, which is a post-processing operation, the standard way it's been done for many years. Fatigue is a post-processing operation with a completely separate and different fatigue solver. Whereas if we move to the Nastran embedded fatigue process, we simplify that and we then have everything completely contained within one input file, which is the Nastran input deck. It contains all of the load information data, all of the fatigue material data, as well as static data. And of course, that is what generates the stresses and then is able to calculate fatigue life directly internally and produce a life and a result of life, which is a very actionable result, even when you've got many, many different inputs and many different combinations of events. And we'll be looking at that with our case study. So the primary advantages with Nastran embedded fatigue, faster, you can see some percentages here, 30 to 60% faster in the testing we've done, much smaller file sizes. Many of these large stress files that you've probably encountered in an unembedded fatigue solution that you have to store are quite large. Those are stored in memory with Nastran embedded fatigue. Simpler, one single simulation. Portable, it's able to be shared with the Nastran deck, and you have all your fatigue and stress life all in one file. Greatly aids communication and portability. It's transparent and accessible to more users because it's in this one format, and you don't have to learn a whole nother piece of software. And of course, better designs. Once you have an embedded solution, what we're able to do is now optimize on fatigue life and use those as our fatigue parameters and fatigue targets and iterate on whatever geometrical or material properties might be desired to achieve a set fatigue life. So let's get right into this case study, which I think will demonstrate things quite clearly. This is a project that was done for Navistar, a truck manufacturer. This is a heavy-duty cab we're going to be looking at. And, of course, Navistar makes many things, trucks, buses, recreational vehicles, engines. And, of course, they've got many simulation-critical applications to achieve optimal designs and reduce testing, faster time to market, and, of course, that all leads to greater innovation. And fatigue life of the cab, which we'll be looking at in this case, is a critically important aspect. You can expect to have a customer desire a million miles of use. That's not uncommon. Of course, fuel efficiency, so you want to keep your weight down, and you need to balance the weight and the life of the cab in order to meet those criteria. So this study demonstrates running a duty cycle inside of Adam's car to predict the loads with flexible bodies from Nastran. And then we transfer those modal responses back to Nastran Embedded Fatigue, do a restart with Nastran Embedded Fatigue to calculate life. And then we'll look at some correlation of fatigue failures from an actual shaker stand test as well. So this is just to show where we are in the process with Nastran Embedded Fatigue as far as developing load histories for the cab, and that's all done completely inside of Adam's and done virtually. Many times this has been done on the test track, which obviously can be not only very expensive, having to actually build a prototype, put it on the track, instrument it, gather the data, reduce it down so it can be used on a shaker test. But of course, if you want to make design changes and you want to go through an iterative loop on that process, it becomes impractical at a certain point. So virtually developing the loads are very important. And this is a diagram I'll be coming back to frequently, because this is what we call the virtual fatigue process cycle, where we start in Nastran for the flexible body generation, develop those modal stiffnesses, or the MNF file, as many of you are familiar with. And those are transferred over to Adams, where we do the multi-body dynamics simulation to generate the road loads. Basically, we're going to drive the vehicle over the loads to develop the modal contributions of those modal stresses. And then we'll transfer those modal scalers back to Nastran Embedded Fatigue. And as I mentioned, do a restart into Nastran Embedded Fatigue and calculate fatigue life. And this is, we'll be demonstrating this at the towards the end of the presentation today. So again, this is kind of a more detailed look at what I had just said as far as how the process basically works. Our loads are developed via simulation rather than test based on the Adams model. And we can take our flexible bodies. In this case, it's the cab, but we could also do multiple or any other components of a vehicle or any other structure that's subjected to loads that you wanted to develop loads virtually inside of Adams. And again, the basic idea is start in Nastran, develop the flexible bodies, bring those flexible bodies over into Adams, develop your loads based on your events inside of Adams, and then bring those modal scalers back into Nastran Embedded Fatigue to calculate life. So here's a look at the basic inputs of this structure. The loads are X, Y, and Z. These are at the connection points. Basically a look at the types of data we're and the number of events we're processing. And that's something that's very important that we'll take a closer look at here, because what we did was we had 11 different events with different durations and different repeats to form one duty cycle, and that duty cycle was the equivalent of 1,197 miles. So, and this has all been determined from accelerated road load testing and so on and so forth. So, the goal with a cab like this is to have it reach 300,000 miles. and that means 250.6 repeats of this duty cycle. And on a shaker stand, that's a 10.1 day event, and you have to have a visual inspection after each 58 minutes to find cracks. And we'll show some images from that. But the main point to show here is that we have many different events with different durations supply completely different stresses and thus have different contributions to fatigue life to the structure. And these were all combined into one solution and came back with one actionable result from which to make design decisions. So a ton of data being reduced down to a very actionable piece of data. So here's a look at the model, one of the roads inside of atoms, and of course we simulate the body, the cab with the frame and the wheels and the tires inside of atoms to capture the road inputs accurately. And again, we'll just run this for each of our events and get back the modal contributions from those and export all those back into Nastran, where we'll set up our duty cycle and then calculate fatigue life. So here's again another look at some of the roads and some of the responses we can get back at those input points. So then when we go back into our FEA model, this is a quick look at the cab, almost 600 degrees of freedom. We use Nastran embedded fatigue to calculate the fatigue life on this model for the entire duty cycle. Again, this includes the Nastran input, includes the material properties, your stress or strain life curves, all your fatigue parameters, and your input loads. And then, of course, it develops the stresses and solves for fatigue life. And here's just a quick look at the modal extraction, some things we used as far as the load history application and so on and so forth as to when we captured data to accurately capture the number of cycles and what our time response should be. And of course, we looked at some of these things. You want to be able to capture your cycles, so you want to maybe look at things in the frequency domain to understand what your frequency load inputs are, so you can determine your proper time step. And really the crux of the issue here is, and the reason we're able to solve this data so efficiently, is we're going to be working not in physical space, but in modal space. And that's what allows us to do these things but with all these, by transferring this modal stresses into the fatigue solver and doing the superposition on those rather than doing it in physical space, which would be extremely untenable, extracting stress every 0.01 seconds for the entire model and then calculating fatigue life on each of that. So if we look at some of the modes that were generated from our flexible body response, these are just some of the modes. I believe we had around 80 some. And these are the stresses associated with those modes. And really what we want to do, and when we go back to these modes, this is what's calculated in the first step for the flexible body MNF file generation. And then Adams generates the modal scalers, which you'll see here are modal contributions for each mode. And these are how these are superimposed inside of the Nastran embedded fatigue solver. And we'll import these from the Adam solution. We'll show that in the demonstration. And again, all these modes are superimposed together, scaled up by the stresses. And then we, of course, get cycles of stress per element. That goes into the cycle counter. It's life is summed based on the SN or strain life curve, and damage is determined for a single event. And then different events will, of course, yield different modal scalers. And then we will combine those events into our duty cycle, and we'll talk about that later on, too. So this really is the fundamental aspect of the process and why, how we're able to do this all inside of one solver and do it in such an efficient manner. Again, all the data is maintained in memory, so we don't have to save files of stress. You can output Nastran, other Nastran requests for the simulation if you'd like, but you don't need to. You can just get fatigue life right out of it. This is just a discussion. There are transient and static cases. We're going to be talking about transient in this case. So those are the fatigue events. Static is working a little bit differently, but I won't discuss that here. And events can be combined into any combination to form duty cycles, as I showed earlier. And again, you can nest those duty cycles, change number of repeats, fool around with them for various conditions to understand very quickly what are the effects of various events and various combinations of events in your duty cycle. So here's a quick look at some results for that full duty cycle. Apologize for the numbers, I'm not sure what's going on with those. But what it comes down to is this is the type of plots you'll get. This is a log of life in miles fringe plot. And it basically comes down to the most critical location yielding a life of 316,228 miles. And yes, it does come out in miles because you can specify, as I mentioned, that one duty cycle, I remember, was around 1,200 miles. And it knows how many duty cycles it needs to go. It survives. So that's how it determines the actual miles and gives back results in that. And as you can see, this is a distribution of what that life plot is like. And of course, this is a ton of data that has now been processed and analyzed, and you can now make design decisions on and really visualize where your critical areas are. And if we look at how this compares to test, some locations of cracks located during the visual inspection, as I mentioned, on the shaker stand, and showing those same locations being identified in the Nastran Embedded Fatigue solution, and a few other critical areas and cracks identified. So again, I've mentioned that you can design and optimize around damage. And this is some of the things we've done in this case: thickened panels, adjusted weld locations, adjusted material selections. Of course, this is now all available in solution 200 to do things like that and say, okay, I want 300,000 miles, change the thickness of my elements so that I get that exact life. That is something we could iterate on now that we have this an embedded solution. And it can be taken care of all internally rather than having to go some external process. And here's a look at, you can also output damage per event to understand where the most critical damaged areas are coming from, which events, and this is just a look at that. I'm going to run through some quick stats on solve times. And when we look at things, this is a quasi-static versus modal transit, and you see we can get quite a significant improvement versus an unembedded solution when we use embedded fatigue, nearly 80%. And again, this whole problem took 24.6 minutes, and that was on a laptop, as a matter of fact. So that's how we ran this full cab through Nastran embedded fatigue. A massive reduction in files because we don't need to save those files. All we really have are one output file that has all your life data maintained in it. You don't need to maintain a full stress history file. And this is a big one too, as far as people who've had to do unembedded approaches and dealing with files and associating time histories to stresses. The beauty of this is there's one input file and one output file with Nastran embedded fatigue. If you were to do the same problem with an unembedded option, you'd have to deal with this many files because you had so many different events and so many different inputs. So that's huge from a user usability standpoint and the general man hours used to deal with the problem. Just in summary, simulated a real-world truck cab, generated flexible bodies in Nastran, developed road loads in atoms, and came back to Nastran embedded fatigue on a large real-world FBA model to predict fatigue life in an accurate fashion. And we support that entire solution chain. So again, the main points of Nastran Embedded Fatigue: it's faster, smaller file sizes, simpler, more portable, more transparent, and optimizable to get the best design possible. And just a quick summary of some of the major points with solution times: only 24.6 minutes, 31 megabytes of file size, and those are just the output files, and only an input and output file to deal with. So massive amounts of data reduced to a single actionable value. That's the really the main thing to take out of this, is we've processed a ton of data and taken it down to one value you can make design decisions on. And when you're designing with just stress as a guide, it can be overly simplistic. As we all know, many times just a stress analysis will not give us the information we need to make a proper design decision. So with that, we will go into a quick demonstration here to demonstrate this cyclic process. And I'm going to start out by bringing up, first let me describe this model a little bit so there's some context. This is a Humvee model, and we're extracting this subframe with eight connection points, as you can see here, as a flexible body. And then we're going to drive this over road loads to develop those modal scalers and bring them back. So what I'm going to bring up in PatTran here, which is a preprocessor for Nastran Embedded Fatigue, is just this subframe. And I'm not going to get into the generation of the flexible bodies, but just to emphasize what this model is, this is just a standard model meshed inside of PatTran, and all the materials are applied. The main thing to show here is the connection points. There's eight of them spiderwebbed out through these MPCs at a single point, and these are our connection points that are transferred over to create the MNF file. And for generating the MNF, it's really quite a simple process of something that's done on the analysis tab. And you'll see I have two analyses here. There's going to be two stages. The first is the MNF generation, and then fatigue. We'll get in fatigue after Yijun is done. And then the main thing I wanted to show here is just the transferring of the modal data over to generate for atoms. And this is where you would do that for your atoms preparation. You can set up the bounds of the modes you want. You can set up your units. And the main thing for this is you want to do an MNF generation and a full run, so we have this data in the database for a restart run. So those are the main things you want to set up. It's a eigenvalue extraction, normal modes, problem of Sol 103 in Nastran speak, that is then run and produces the MNF file. And I actually have, as you can see here, this is my running directory where I ran it, and this produced the subframe MNF model, and this is the model that I transferred over to Yijun, and he then ran the Adams Rhodes loads extraction. So I'll pass that over to him to show that.
Okay, thank you, Mark. You want me to take back the control now?
Yes.
Okay. All right, okay, thank you. Let's assume Mark is the Nastran guy here and I'm the Adams guy in this workflow. So let me share my desktop. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so this is the Humvee model in Adams car environment. So the first thing I'm going to do is to replace this rigid body subframe with the flexible body MNF file that Mark provided. So what I'm going to do is to choose this subframe and right click. and make flexible. So here I'm going to import MNF file. And I will choose the MNF file that Mark provided. And I will click line flex bodies, center of mass with the center of mass of current parts. Okay, then let's go to connections. So basically, it automatically identifies all the connection points and connects this new flexible body with the rest, with the adjacent parts of the rest of the suspension system. And I click OK. Then, as you can see, this flexible body is on the flexible subframe is on the new suspension system. Okay, then what I'm going to do is that I'm going to run a smart drive event. So go to full vehicle analysis and then add smart driver. Output for, prefix, I will say, let's use the name Belgium Road here. And time, say 5 seconds. So the number of steps, that really depends on how the fatigue analysis would need. So you generally you can give quite a small step duration for small time duration for each step. So you get a finer results, finer loading loads results for the upcoming fatigue analysis. And here I'm going to choose the 3D Belgium road. Okay, auto calculate, user define. You can either check this box or you can uncheck that. That doesn't matter too much. So when you click apply, basically it will run through Belgium road road test on Adam's car, and you will get the load that's generated using this Adam's car based on this event. So it will take you about 5 minutes to run this particular event. And now I'm gonna use the simulation results that was run earlier on my computer. And of course, if you want to perform load events on different road types, you can do that and provide the relevant materials or provide the relevant files to Mark afterwards. So after I'm done with this simulation, what I'm going to do, so first I'm going to go to the tools and open the plugin manager. So I want to make sure that Adam's durability is loaded before I can export this load to any kind of fatigue software for Mark to use. So first I want to make sure that Adam's durability plugin is loaded. And then to export the DAG files that's needed for Mark to perform the fatigue analysis, I will go to the durability tab, FE fatigue. And then export. So the flexible body that I'm going to use is this is the one that I'm using here. And the job name, I can assign it to be Belgium Road. So I don't need this FES file format. I can include the modal velocities. So also, if you want to start on the instant that this vehicle start to go through this rough road, that will also be fine. So usually that is the basic step you want to do to export this DAG file. Okay, so now this is my working directory. You can see there are 64 modes for this particular model and event. And there are one deck file for each mode. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to just zip those 64 deck files and send it to Mark. And that's all. So I'm done with the, that's how I'm done with the atoms part. And okay, I'm going to pass the presenter back to Mark at this point. Okay.
Thank you. Let me bring it back up my desktop here.
Okay.
All righty. So, so now that Yuzhen has provided me with my road loads in the form of modal scalars, I can now set up my fatigue analysis. And again, we're going to use this, for all intents and purposes, the same model. And then there's just a few inputs we need for fatigue. First off, of course, are materials. And what we've added now on our materials form inside of Fatran is not only static materials, but we've got options for stress life and strain life. And this will define your life curve, which is ultimately how damage will be summed. And this is all in standard ways, or you can auto-generate them. You can do derived parameters as well based on ultimate tensile strength and various other material types. But in this case, I actually knew my parameters as far as what the slopes of this EN curve in this case would look like. So this is really the material properties that define the life of the part when it is subjected to cyclic loading. So we've got our material properties in there, and there's three inputs. There's materials, there's loads, and there's the stresses, and the stresses are calculated and already calculated from the modal standpoint. So we need now to apply the loads. And what we can do is actually take a quick look. I've loaded in the DAC files, which is the standard time history format already. What you can see here is I've got the full list of these 64. And we can just pick one just to show. But what we've got here is these are the actual scale factors, modal participations, through time on this mode. In this case, it's mode number 35. And of course, we've got these through for all the modes, and this is how the stresses are going to be scaled and superimposed inside the cycle counter and the solver. So this is what Yuzhen has sent over to me. So, with that, we need to then associate those modal scalars with our loads. And that is done here when we set up our fatigue job. And again, we're going to be staying in a normal modes SOL 103 analysis. And we're going to set up our fatigue parameters. And this is where we set up all of that. What you can see here is I've decided to do a strain life analysis. You can also run an SN or a total life analysis and set up parameters for that by checking the various boxes. But these are the parameters. Won't get into all of these, but we can do factor of safety analyses, which is how much if you have infinite life, your loads can be scaled up to reach a certain life. Options for time history compression if you've got really long, complex time histories, and then how to deal with potential static failures. But these are where we set up our fatigue parameters. And once those are set up, what we want to do is associate our modes with the DAC files we were just looking at. So we pull up our event manager here, And you see on the left, we've got a list of load sequences which we can combine. And then here we've got our events. Now the main thing to note here is it knows right away that we've got 64 modes. We scroll all the way down because I've extracted those and read in the results. And then we want to associate those with the modal response. And these are the files that Yijun just generated, and now I'm associating with their appropriate stresses. And what I've done here, this is the Belgian road event. If we wanted to find other events, I just kind of made some up. We don't have them, but if we had a railroad crossing or a pothole, we could have events like that too. And those would be, again, the modes would be the same, but we would have different DAC files associated with them that were generated from atoms. And then, so those are our events. And here's where we would have our duty cycle. So again, I've got a Belgian only here, but if I wanted to add an event to this duty cycle, as I said, I've already got this these events defined. Say I want to do a railroad crossing and repeat it 5 times, I can hit apply, and this then becomes part of this duty cycle. And I could do the same thing if I wanted to add a new sequence and add an event to this. And again, I can even nest it by putting a previously defined duty cycle inside another duty cycle. So all of this is available. As you can see, you can combine these into any way you might want and edit them in any way. So that's how we set up our loads. Once that's done, that's really all there is to it. We've now input our material properties. We've input our loading scenario, and our stresses are already calculated. We send this off to the Nastran solver, and we actually do a restart from the previous flexible body generation. There's no need to re-perform the eigenvalue extraction analysis, which is a huge benefit. That's already in the database, so we can get those stresses associated with the loads and calculate fatigue life. And that about does it.